My name is Panos Konstantopoulos. I'm professor in the Department of Informatics, Athens University of Economics and Business, and the Digital Curation Unit, Athena Research Center. This tutorial introduces the basic principles and techniques that can be used in order to formulate the knowledge you have about a specific domain in such a way that it can be understood and used in reasoning tasks by both humans and machines. It is important to have the notion that the knowledge about a domain guides the way we formulate information about specific items each time. Take, for instance, the ancient Temple of Poseidon in Corinthia. There's a host of information about it, excavation records that come in the forms of notebooks and drawings and images, as well as a number of publications, such as excavation reports or edited volumes, monographs, journal articles. In fact, there is a good collection of online resources that you can find at the address that you see on the slide, and three-dimensional reconstructions. Now, the question is, how do you go about organizing the information that exists if you want to have it in a consistent collection, and how do you go about finding this information? Other example, in a museum context, there are very different kinds of tangible objects that belong to museum collections, and these are customarily recorded by the documentation department of the museum using specific cataloging systems. For instance, the Museum Documentation Association object card, here we see the front side of the object card, prescribes a number of fields that can be used in order to record specific information about each object, such as an object name, alternative object names, a brief description, the creator, where it was made, places associated with the history of this object, and so forth. We need to understand what a model is. A model, we use the term model in order to mean some representation of a part of the real world. For instance, a map of London, or the catalogue of the Library of Alexandria, or Maxwell's equations. These are models of specific parts of the world, and the part of the world that a model describes is called the domain that we are interested in. The important point is that a model describes a part of the world by throwing away a lot of information that is unnecessary. So it is an abstract representation, and the abstraction is made from one or several points of view. And the points of view determine exactly what information we keep and what we throw away. So a model is an abstract representation of the world. And in fact, in the examples we saw before, such as the MDA object card, we do have an abstract representation of objects because we select exactly what information to keep about them. But then there's also another meaning to the word model. By model, we also mean the framework we use in order to build such abstract representations, a template or the recipe that we abide by in order to produce such presentations. And in fact, the MDA card we saw before is such a model. When we fill in the details describing any particular object, we get a description of that particular object. So, for example, cartographic conventions is the framework for making maps. A database schema for library cataloging is the framework for developing the catalog of the Library of Alexandria. Differential equations is the framework in which Maxwell's equations are formulated. So any such framework provides three things. The first is the kind of symbols or symbolic structures that we can use to build a model, to build a representation. The second is the kind of operations we can perform on these symbols in order to construct complex representations from simpler ones or to derive representations from others that existed before. And finally, it provides a set of rules according to which symbolic representations are valid or invalid. So rules that define the valid symbolic structures and the valid transformations of symbolic structures are the third important part of such a framework that we call a model. So loosely speaking, these elements of a model follow the elements that we find in a language. There is a grammar, there is a syntax, and there is also the correspondence between the symbols in the language and what is meant in the real world, that is the semantics. So, such a framework effectively is a formal, artificial language that allows to build abstract representations of reality, avoiding, however, the ambiguities of natural language, but also, of course, at the cost of not being able to record the nuances and the wealth of nuances that natural language allows. Now we turn our attention to the representation frameworks, that is, the models that we use in order to represent and organize data that we store in computers, and these we call data models. The data models are models that explicitly determine the structure of data in describing a particular domain, and in fact there are different kinds of models. We have so-called physical models, and the object there is to design the data, and the concern of the design then is how to use storage in the best possible way and how a database management system works. So the physical models are concerned with designing the data in order to implement DBMSs. Now, then there are logical models, which are data representations that are independent of any specific database management system, yet they are formulated in terms of technology-specific data structures. For example, relational tables, in order to work with relational database management systems, object-oriented classes, or XML tags, if we are to produce XML documents. And then there is a third level of models, so-called conceptual models. Now, they are called conceptual models because they are representation frameworks that are technology independent, and they are specifically designed to be more or less akin to the way that the human mind conceives reality. So they are much easier for a human to follow. They can be used as a communication medium between humans, and at the same time, they work as a specification for exactly how to structure information in order to be used by machines. And what happens in practice is that we tend to work with conceptual models because it is easier for us, and then these are translated into the appropriate logical models according to the technology that is going to be used, and then the appropriate physical models that are tied to the specific implementation. Conceptual models are made up of symbolic structures of three different kinds: objects or entities, attributes, and relations. Let's start with an example. The Parthenon is an object or entity. If we say the Parthenon has height 14 meters, then the statement that it has a height of 14 meters is an attribute. And if we say that the Parthenon is in proximity to the Erechtheion, then this is a relation between the Parthenon and the Erechtheion. So, objects or entities are items that exist by themselves, and we can talk about them in their own right, regardless of anything else that exists. Attributes are properties that these objects have and describe those objects, and relations presume the existence of two particular objects that are related in some specific way. By naming the relation, we actually express the specific way in which these objects or entities are related. So, to recapitulate, attributes describe properties of an entity by itself, and relations always involve two entities. Now, another way of distinguishing these symbolic structures is to distinguish between what we call instances and classes. Instances are atomic entities, and classes are sets of entities that are of the same kind. So the Parthenon is an instance, whereas temple denotes a class. Aphrodite of Milos is an instance, but statue is a class. And the Parthenon is an instance belonging to the class temple, and the Aphrodite of Milos is an instance belonging to the class statue. Instances are also called particulars, and classes are also called universals. And as I said before, the relationship between instances and classes is that instances belong to the appropriate classes, which means that they have the characteristics that are implied by that class. The classes are actually operating, they are behaving as carriers of characteristics which the instances of that class share. Complete abstract description of a domain, so a complete representation of a domain, includes two parts. One part describes the general knowledge we have about that domain, and the other part describes the specific information that we have about each item that we know to be included in that domain. The first part is called a schema. So the schema specifies classes of entities, specifies attributes that the entities can have, and relations that can exist between those entities, and of course, any other rules that may apply. And as I said, it expresses the general knowledge about the domains, or else called the categorical knowledge about the domain. That is the knowledge about the categories that constitute this domain. The data is a collection of statements for each of the items that belong to the domain. So the data comprises instances of the elements of the schema, and in fact instances of the elements of the schema that conform to the rules of the schema. And they describe a specific state of affairs at a particular point in time. So at any particular point in time, the set of data we have describes exactly what we know about the domain at that time. Let me make the remark at this point that there is no single best model for describing a given domain. Whether a model is good or not depends on exactly what we want to do with the information we have about that domain, what are the kinds of questions we want to answer, what exactly we need to do is what determines whether a model is adequate and whether it is complete. Let us see how we might go about formulating a very simple model. And in fact, the steps that we will take now is exactly what you do every time we are building a model, be it very simple or very complex. We will start from a natural language statement and see how we can transform this into an encoded statement that takes the form of a model. So the statement goes as follows. A particular Lekythos number 1055, according to the register of the museum, found at Dipylon in 1891, weighs 1.5 kilos and carries a depiction showing Theophanti. To turn this into a semantic model, we will encode subject-verb-object structures as relational triples of the form entity 1, relation entity 2, or as shown graphically here, we use a circle or an oval or a box to denote entities, and we use arrows to denote relations, because relations are directed. There is a direction from entity 1 to entity 2. So in the case of the example, we color the various words in the sentence, Lekythos number 1055 found at Dipylon, etc., that we showed before. And we have noun phrases that we have turned red and verbal phrases that we have turned green, because it is the noun phrases that denote the entities in the domain, and it is the verbal phrases that denote relations or attributes. So what we get is a set of ovals that denote the various entities. So we have the entity Lekythos number 1055, the entity representing the particular depiction, so we have named it this depiction. Another entity denoting the person that is depicted in the figure, Theophanti. The entity Dipylon, which is the place that the Lekythos was found at. And we have the arrow with the label carries to denote the relation that Lekythos carries this depiction. The arrow labeled depicts to denote the relation that the depiction depicts a particular figure, Theophanti. And we have the arrow found at to denote the relation that Lekythos number 1055 was found at Dipylon. And then we have another arrow labeled by the verb weighs to denote that this Lekythos weighs 1.5 kilos. And yet another arrow, which emanates from the arrow found at, labeled when, to tell us that the finding of Lekythos 1055 at Dipylon took place in 1891. The remark here is that Lekythos as an entity is related to the depiction, it is related to the place, and it has an attribute describing its property of having a weight, the attribute weighs. But then in the very same way that the entity can have an attribute, also a relation can have attributes, such as the relation of found at, because the year 1891 is the year of the finding. It does not characterize the Lekythos, it does not characterize the place, it rather characterizes the relation between the Lekythos and the place, that it was found at, that the Lekythos was found at the place at a particular time. And in this picture, you see that relations and attributes are all depicted as arrows. They are appropriately labeled in order to convey the meaning of this relation or attribute. And also note that the values of the attributes, in the case of the weight 1.5 kilos, in the case of the year of the finding 1891, are also depicted as ovals, because as we shall see in a while, they can be treated in a very similar way as entities. But we'll move to that a little later. Now, it is quite normal to think that we can make a model that would convey this information, but in fact, it would depict the general situation. So the situation depicted now is a model that involves not particular instances, but classes of instances. Remember the distinction between instances and classes that we introduced before. And note that every item at the bottom of the picture, at the bottom of the slide, that is Lekythos number 1055, this depiction, Theophanti, etc., is an instance of a class that is found at the top part of the slide. The general knowledge about the domain is captured by the top part. We have classes that are connected between them by relations, and they carry attributes describing their properties. And then each time we want to describe any particular item, such as Lekythos number 1055, we instantiate, as we say, the classes of the top model in order to get the bottom part of the model. And the relation between classes and instances is there. So Lekythos 1055 is instance of Lekythos, this depiction is instance of depiction, Theophanti is instance of figure, Dipylon is instance of place, and as you shall see, the number 1891 is instance of year, and 1.5 kilo is instance of weight. So that concludes the introduction of the way we will be working. We will be producing models at the level of classes to capture the knowledge we have about a domain, and then we will instantiate them to present the knowledge we have about specific items.